One of my longtime clients, which is a lady, about 20% of all our clients are women, non-custodial mothers and regular mothers and so on, who come to us for whatever reason. And this right here is Stacy McDonald. Hello, Stacy.
Hi.
Thank you for joining us today.
You're welcome.
And this is the topic of the show. This is Lila, the miracle baby. Yes. And tell us a little bit about Lila.
Well, Lila is 3 months old. She was born 26 weeks into my pregnancy, which is roughly 5 or 6 months. She came into the world pretty much undeveloped. She was kind of half-baked, I like to say. She came underdeveloped lungs. Vessels in her head were bleeding because of going through the birth canal. You know, it was traumatic for her to come through the birth canal. So
she was ready to come out.
She was ready. She was ready. She was ready, probably spiritually, but physically, her body was not prepared.
But let me just get this straight. So, when she was born, she was still like
developing.
And what does that mean? Like the organs were
the
not?
The organs were not developed. They were not fully functioning.
Oh, okay.
Yes, because she was so young and so small.
So technically, she's been born for 3 months now, but mm-hmm. she was supposed to be born like maybe this particular
exactly,
week.
Exactly, this week.
All
exactly.
right, so that's what you call a miracle, coming that premature and going through all the different phases of development and having so many people assist and
right.
and so on. So she was sort of like born with a machine.
So basically. basically,
I notice even right now that she has
oxygen.
Oxygen everywhere she goes.
Yes, they have to be carried with her. She has to wear it in the house. She'll be wearing this for probably about 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh, 2 months. And it's just to assist her with her feeding, because you know how when we eat, we swallow it and then we breathe.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she has the breathing part down. It's just she doesn't have enough power to expand her lungs
yet.
So the oxygen assists her with that.
I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you have like a major medical biller, I mean major medical coverage or...
Yeah.
When she was first born, she went, where did she go?
She went to Women and Children's Hospital.
Women and Children's Hospital?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay, we really want to commend the Women's and Children's Hospital. They do a magnificent job
yes,
with premature
yes,
babies.
Yes, they do. Their neonatal unit is probably the best in the world.
Is that right? What's the name of it?
What?
The unit.
Neonatal Intensive Care Unit.
Oh, neonatal.
Neonatal, yes.
Okay, so we want to applaud them because they did such a tremendous job on keeping Lila alive and strong.
Definitely.
Of course, there were some other contributing factors to her being here today. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the things that you went through, just so that people, if you have a premature child, or if this should be, you know, someone in your family has a premature child, we don't want it. It's sort of overwhelming. She's going to describe the way the child looked when she first got with Lila and what she had to go through in watching that development. So we just want to prepare you and give you some insight after the experience that her and her child went through and the benefit that the hospital played. Well, welcome everybody. This is Blaze, and this is Unified Fathers for Life, and Unified Fathers for Life is dedicated to reuniting families just one father at a time. However, tonight, in case you were wondering what you were looking at, that was the first show we did with Lila, the miracle baby, and her mother Stacy, and now we are for an update as to what the situation turned out with the miracle baby, who was born prematurely and had to go through all kinds of changes. Remember, you say you could see right through her skin and see her veins, huh?
Yes, she was very
well, this is Stacy. In case you're wondering, no, we didn't redo her hair that quick. Her hair has grown and has been touched up since the first show. Okay, so let me just familiarize you with some of the things that have happened at that time. Lila had not been diagnosed, so Lila was diagnosed, she was 4 months old for that show. And so Lila was diagnosed with cerebral palsy at the age of 6 months old. CP is a neurological disorder in which portions of the brain have been damaged due to trauma suffered during birth or some traumatic brain injury. It affects a person's body movements and or language. Do you want that? Body movement and or language. What does that mean? Body movements. Tell them what that means.
That means that depending upon what type of cerebral palsy you have, your body can either be very stiff or have hypertonia, or it can be very loose.
And what I have discovered is that there are various degrees of cerebral palsy. Luckily for us, Lila has been diagnosed as mild. She is mild at cerebral palsy.
Yes, she has mild cerebral palsy.
And her muscles are very stiff and have a heightened tone in them that sometimes will make it difficult for her to walk and move certain parts of her body. So, and we'll get to, in August, she was prescribed to braces. Now, we just want to let some of the people know that these developmental changes developmental changes for her are slow.
Yes.
And it varies with different children who have cerebral palsy.
Exactly.
Now, she was diagnosed at 6 months old, and sometimes people take a long time to diagnose to realize that their child has cerebral palsy.
Yes.
So you had tremendous benefits from the very beginning because you went to what institution?
I went to...
You got to give them their props.
Women and Children's Hospital is where she was born, but she's actually being followed up in their high-risk infant clinic. It's called the Premature Infant Clinic.
Okay.
Yes.
So now at 6 months, that was 4 months, and at 6 months, mm-hmm. she was diagnosed with cerebral palsy. What was your reaction as a mother?
Were
you in denial or what?
Well, first of all, I was shocked because I didn't know what cerebral palsy was. I mean, I knew the general definition, but I had never known someone who had cerebral palsy, so I knew nothing about it.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a little bit of denial in the beginning.
Yes.
Thank you.
There was a little bit of denial?
In the beginning, yes, but as the months progress, of course, you know, all the information that you can. You begin to educate yourself, and then, you know, it's you're better equipped to handle.
So just so some people get an idea, because people may not be familiar with cerebral palsy, but they are familiar with babies.
Yes.
So when she was 6 months old, what was it she was not doing to indicate to the doctor?
First of all, her muscles were very tight. Her entire body was extremely tight. Her hands were always fisted. As they were when we were here before, and she wasn't, so the tightness in her body prohibited her from rolling over, you know, from moving her body as a normal child would. And so that was the indicator to her pediatrician, Dr. Pena, that she had cerebral palsy and that it was mild. She was able to say, you know, with certainty at that time.
So that's a good
the
thing.
The degree, yes.
So children or people, I guess I should say, is it only children that have cerebral palsy, by the way, that contracted? I mean, is it from birth or can someone later on?
Oh, okay. I'm not sure.
But usually it's something
happens.
Well,
I would assume that you could because it comes from anyone who sustains a traumatic brain injury. Remember, Lila sustained brain hemorrhaging when she came through the birth canal.
Mm-hmm.
So I would assume that if you, you know, were in an accident of some sort, you could probably... But it's prevalent only with premature infants.
Okay, so now we want to let people know some of the challenges you had to face and overcome. And so, first of all, give them an idea of what she was doing when she was 6 months to a year.
Okay.
How was she getting around?
She was being carried around.
Okay,
she was being carried around
because she couldn't even crawl.
No, she could not crawl because her muscles were so stiff. She could not crawl. She could not roll over. And it was very difficult because she basically had to be...
Okay, and she's one of my clients, so I stopped by and I noticed that her feet weren't touching or something.
Yes,
that like?
That was...
Describe that for the audience.
She would, well, most, actually some kids do that before they learn to walk, will stand on their tippy toes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but the only difference with Lila is that her heels never touch the ground,
mm-hmm.
ever. You know, some kids will... you know, lift their feet up, but they bring them down. And her muscles and her ankles were so stiff that she could not put her feet on the ground.
So now, you go to class, you know, I get your note here, it says she goes to school, but you go with
yes,
her.
Yes, I go with her.
Well, how many times so our people know what type of mother you are? This is Valentine's Day, and I should have brought you a card because you're a great mother, you really
thank you,
are.
Thank you.
So tell us the regiment that's involved in securing the fact, because primarily if the right things are done, she can pretty much lead a normal life by the time
exactly.
she grows up. So
exactly.
let's tell them a little bit about why she had to get the braces, what it was like for her
okay.
getting around.
Okay, well, let's just go back. So 6 months old, she was diagnosed with cerebral palsy. The doctor recommended that she go through intensive therapy, whether it be physical, occupational.
It's a pretty expensive endeavor, isn't it?
Yes, it is, Michael.
But go ahead. You're going to the doctor 4 or 5 times a week, but we'll talk about that
okay.
blessing later.
So she was prescribed intensive therapy. So she receives a physical therapy two days a week and occupational therapy, in which they teach her how to feed herself, dress herself, you know, with toileting, daily activities or skills for daily living. And the physical
skills
therapy.
Skills for daily living.
Yes.
I like that. I need some of that. But go ahead.
And so the physical therapist works out her body. She exercises her body.
Really?
Yes, because it helps her to maintain her balance and her posture, and which will, you know, enable her to walk, because she's not walking at this time.
She was not walking at this time, or
she's
she wasn't
walking.
Walking at that time?
She's not walking. Okay, she's not walking independently. She walks with assistance.
What did I read? Where's my note? Oh, here we go.
Yes.
Cruising along.
Okay, yes.
Have I jumped too far?
I don't know, but we can jump back.
Okay.
Okay, so after the physical, okay, she's followed, because she's followed up by so many specialists. She has a specialist from head to toe. So she went for her first evaluation with an orthopedic surgeon,
mm-hmm.
and he recommended braces. They're called ankle-foot orthotics. We'll lift the leg up here for a minute.
And tell them what she was doing prior to having
prior to the braces, she was not walking. She was not, she wasn't doing anything. I don't want to take her shoe off.
Oh, so those are her braces.
Yes,
yeah.
These are her braces. And they're plastic.
And they just gave them to you, huh?
Yes.
I guess they were fitted for her.
Yes, they were fitted for her. So he recommended that the braces, she wear the braces because they would, they would release the pressure.
Oh, how cool.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
And she had her little Hawaiian print. But they would release the pressure between, you know, her hip, her knees, and her ankles, to release the pressure and the stiffness in her legs, to allow her legs to relax so that she could straighten them out. Her foot could be flat. As you see, this is pressing, it's forcing her foot to touch the ground.
Oh, to let the heel
yes,
touch.
Yes, it relaxes the muscles between here so that her foot can relax and touch the ground,
oh, nice.
Allowing her to walk.
Oh, that's a good
Isn't
picture
cool?
of it,
that's
too.
Cool. So this allows her to walk. So if we can stand her up, before she wasn't standing at all. When she met with Dr. K, she was not standing. She couldn't stand on her own. Now Miss Lila can move around on her own.
So
yes?
Now I learned this term. Let's see. In August of 2006, she was prescribed braces for her legs because of the stiffness in her legs prevented her heels from touching the floor. 4 months later, she was cruising along the furniture
right.
and making her way around with minimal assistance. Now, explain to the audience what this term,
okay,
cruising
if you have
along
children,
means.
You know what cruising means. Your children hold onto the furniture like she's doing now, and she moves along.
And this is something she was deprived.
She was not doing.
She could not do. So now she was up. Looking at people and being
yes.
a part of the world.
Yes.
Was there a distinct joyfulness about her or what?
For her, of course. Can you imagine? You're sitting there looking at things you could previously not touch, and now all of a sudden you can stand up and you can see, you know, on top of the dresser or on top of the stove. So now she's opening drawers and opening doors and seeing what's, well, you know, she's exploring her world now.
So we want to say, many other toddlers have to utilize walkers and other equipment and things like that. So it's very important that she be allowed to progress normally as possible, allowing her to develop at her own pace.
Exactly.
So about where is she at now?
Where is she? She's cruising along the furniture. So she's on her way to walking, and she's doing it without equipment. You know, without a walker. She's not going to need a walker. She's not going to need a
Those
wheelchair.
Those braces are so lightweight.
Yes, they're light, very lightweight.
My
but
goodness.
They're very durable, and they're doing their job, as you can see. This is like it's like wearing a cast, almost. If you touch it. You can touch it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a cast. Yes.
Fantastic.
So it's very durable. Yes.
There are a large number of people who have cerebral palsy,
they
and
are.
I don't know it or something.
Yes. Yes. Because some people, like the severity...
You know what I'm thinking of?
What?
I'm thinking of polio. That's what I'm from my childhood. I remember a lot of kids
yes.
had polio. They don't have it now.
A lot of kids had cerebral palsy in your day too, but the braces looked different. You could know because they were those metal braces,
mm-hmm.
those big, huge ones that went all the way up the leg. So
let's talk a little more about all this assistance from all these doctors and specialists and And I mean, they've been dealing with her nonstop throughout her life.
Yes, since
birth.
The same
people.
The same exact people.
So she's got a gang of mothers and fathers that love her and work with her.
Well, I think those, I call them her dream team.
Dream team.
That's her dream team.
Yeah, I like that.
Yes.
The dream team.
That's her dream team.
And what's the institution again?
It's, I guess it would be the USC Medical Network, LAUSC Medical Center Network.
Now, I noticed she has her headset on, her earphones.
Yes.
She's into that music thing or
Yes,
what?
She loves music. She the first time she heard music, she was enthused. She was very drawn to it, and she has been since.
All right. And so she sings and
she sings, yes.
Plays and gets into all that.
Yes.
Now, I want to say the other side of it is that you also have a genius for a son.
Yes.
I mean, her son is literally a genius. I think I met him when he was, 12?
Yes,
something
he was
like
12
that.
Years
he had
old, yes.
his own complete coloring book, complete with illustrations. He had no computer, he had complete illustrations. He had characters that had distinctions, like what they would do, superpowers. And,
and believe it or not, he knew that. He knew that he was going to do that when
and
he was 5 years old.
And he had several volumes.
Yes, he did.
He put discounts in there, buy two and get this. And he was selling comic books on a regular basis, and he didn't even have a computer.
Yes.
So, you know, he also requires a whole lot of time and attention, right?
Definitely.
You know, I'm beginning to think that you might be overworked.
I'm beginning to think that I am.
Give them an example of what type of mother you have to be to ensure the fact that she gets the greatest opportunity in leading a normal life.
You have to be selfless. You have to put her first. Her needs come first. So basically, I'm on the back burner. You know, I'm at the bottom of the priority list because.
But seeing all this development, seeing this joy, what is that?
You had
a line in here. There is a great joy in this experience, which began very turbulently.
Mm-hmm.
I, for the first time in my life, have a great appreciation for the human experience. I have learned that we are all resilient creatures who can overcome anything, and we are absolutely born with the willingness to persevere through great struggle.
That's right.
Can I quote you on
that? Yes, you can.
That
because
was
it's
beautiful.
Absolutely true. Just here you see this little bitty baby who comes into the world. You know, totally, you know, not fully developed.
Tell them how much she weighed.
She weighed less than a pound. And now she, how many pounds do you weigh? Like 40 pounds now?
When she was on this show, you guys saw that first show from, about 18 months ago
yes.
or something like
yes.
that.
Yes.
She was like about that big.
Mm-hmm.
And she had oxygen
mm-hmm.
and, you know. And
she was poked and had surgeries. She's been,
she's had tubes
in every part of her body. Yeah, so for her to overcome that and then have to overcome these, you know, the physical part of her condition is totally amazing. You know, I mean, if it were any of us on any given day, we'd give up, give them the bed.
What do you think would have happened without the support these institutions have been giving you continuously?
She would be, I would still find a way.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
So let's just.
All right.
I would find a way.
If you had to go back to school, huh?
Yes, I would find a way, yes. Because
you know,
it's important. It's important.
Okay. We also want to talk about the Kid Power and the Exceptional Children Foundation. These are key institutions. So let's start with what is Kid Power to people or parents with cerebral palsy? And so we give a shout out to that Kid Power concept. Where does it go and how do you work
it? Well, it's kidpower.org. It is actually a Yahoo online support group for parents of children with mild forms of cerebral palsy. We all get together on the internet and we exchange information, ideas, give advice, support to families and parents who are struggling, who are either beginning, you know, at the beginning where I was, or who are gone beyond where I am, you know, so they can offer, you know, information to me, and it's totally amazing.
What have you seen? What other older mild cerebral palsy children have you seen that you think she'll be able to?
Oh, I've seen kids who are in college.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
Oh, because when I read it, it
yes.
said, no, they can probably end up just go slower with development, but she
yes.
can develop
yes.
and everything and get everything going good.
Yes, yes. Because cerebral palsy is manageable. You know, if you have the right preventative measures in place and you get it early enough, it can be managed. You know, it's just learning a different way to work her body and her mind, her brain. That's it. That's all it is. And so with that, as you can see, she's... You wouldn't know it, you know, just by looking at her. You wouldn't know that she even had, any type of disability.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Just by looking
See,
at
now,
it.
I saw her out the braces, and, and she was like...
Yes, exactly.
She was like...
Crawling like a vet, like
how
a...
How you say
what those people call?
Yeah.
Like she's
She would just move her hands.
Yes.
And drag her
yes.
and pull herself.
But see how determined she was?
Yeah.
She didn't care.
And she was so big, because she's like, just so they'll know, now she's two. She started like, what, less than a pound. This is just so phenomenal to me.
Absolutely.
You know, and I think it's a reflection that she has a great mother, that's for sure.
Thank you.
So tell us a little more about how Kid Power has helped, and then we'll go to Exceptional Children Foundation also and see what they have to offer parents that have cerebral palsy. Well, first of all, I saw a place where a lot of parents didn't know their children had it.
Mm-hmm.
So what would you say to them?
I would say if you have a suspicion that something's not right, you know, your kids are not doing things that you think that they should be doing at whatever age they're in, stage they're in, that you should consult your doctor. Go straight to the doctor. Don't delay. Don't just say, well, maybe they'll grow out of it, because they won't grow out of it. Mm-hmm. Although cerebral palsy does not worsen as she gets older, her condition will always remain the same. It's just you want to always increase their quality of life, no matter what their disability is. You know, you always want to help them to increase their quality of life. So the earlier you get it done, the earlier you get the diagnosis and the therapies in place, the better off they'll be.
Let's talk about the word disability.
Right.
Excuse me. What does that mean to you now?
It means...
Now that you've lived this experience, compared to what it might have meant to you before, now that it's personal.
I don't view Lila as someone who is disabled. I view her as someone who has special needs. She just needs a little extra special attention. She has a different way of doing things. But I don't think her condition is disabling. She's still able to, you know, move fairly independently. So I don't view her as a disabled person. But medically, she is, you know, she has a disability.
This is so cool.
This is great.
I'm so glad. You know, we've been talking about doing this show from the time we did the first show.
Well,
we got to do show two. But I think this is ideal. To say developmentally she is delayed in that she functions at 12 to 15 months level.
Right.
That means she's making milestones somewhat late in certain areas, like gross and fine motor skills. What are gross and fine motor skills
audience? Gross and fine motor skills are things like being able to stack things, being able to place things in something and pull them out, just little things like that. Being able to write, hold a pen or a crayon and write, things of that nature.
She tries to use crayons?
Yes, she does. Yes, she does.
Oh, because her brother.
And he helps her a lot. He actually taught her how to drink out of a straw and to ride a bicycle.
Oh, really?
To ride a tricycle,
a bicycle?
Yes.
She rides
She's
a bike?
Very, yes, she,
and she can't walk,
paddles.
But she can ride a bike. How nice.
And he taught her to do that. And she adores him. If he says it's raining and it's sunny outside, it's raining in her world because he said it. Yes. So she's very receptive to him. So he's very helpful in that manner.
I like that.
Helping her to learn new things.
I like that. So share with us a little more about, you say here things began turbulently. What was it like in the beginning?
You know, it's been so long. It's been 2 years. And I can't really remember everything.
Oh, that's right. You're so busy.
Now it's hectic. It's just a hectic lifestyle. It's like, you know, I'm her chauffeur, I'm her advocate, I'm her everything. I'm like her. So it's just I'm living two lives, basically, you know, making sure that she's where she's supposed to be on time, she's getting what she needs, she's participating when she gets there. You know, I'm getting information from them if I need any, and that's it.
How does she participate?
She follows instruction, because basically her therapy is they play. They give her therapy through the art of play.
Oh, so, I read somewhere.
Yes.
I took a crash course, something about music therapy as well.
Yes, but she doesn't have music therapy, but I'm looking into that, because as you see, she loves music. But her therapy is basically play. They play with blocks, puzzles, different manipulatives.
She loves her mommy, huh?
Yes, different manipulatives. To help her to enhance her fine and gross motor skills, like, you know, as I said, picking things up, being able to utilize her hands and her arms. At one time, she was very left-hand dominant, and this one, she acted like it wasn't even there. Her right hand just did not exist. And so through her occupational therapy, they taught her to use both hands, you know, simultaneously.
Well, last time, she wouldn't make any noise.
But she was asleep.
I'm dying for her to start talking. Go, girl. Yeah. I love it. I'm sorry I interrupted.
That's okay. And so that's what she's doing. And so moving on to the Exceptional Children's Foundation.
Yes.
Yes, she's participating in an...
Well, tell them a little bit about what the Exceptional Children's Foundation is.
The Exceptional Children's Foundation, I don't know exactly everything that
Wait, I see it. It's a center-based infant development program.
But they offer more than just that, but that's just the program that we participate in. Okay.
Oh, so and it's about stimulating, educational stimulation.
Exactly.
Oh.
Through play. And so she's there with other children. It's a preschool setting, so she's there with other children, and they have circle time where they sing songs and they interact with their teachers, and then they have table time where they're doing different things like sensory activities, you know, playing with clay or paint or water. One day I know they were teaching them to wash baby dolls just to get the different...
Feeling the textures,
hot and cold, and all of those things. And then they have playtime, of course, where they go outside to play so they can interact with each other. And snack time, and it's time to go home.
What kind of toys does she play with?
Everything that she has to have music on it. It's only that she'll pay attention to it. And now she's into Legos. She likes Legos. She's learning to stack the Legos, so she's into Legos. And her bicycle. Yes.
And her bicycle, that's cool. Isn't so she cool? Riding a bike before she can walk.
Yes, exactly.
That's like what cross training, huh?
Exactly.
So those muscles are getting what
they
need.
They're getting what they need.
What did the doctor say when you told him she learned to ride the bike? Was he surprised?
Her doctor doesn't know yet, but her physical therapist came yesterday, and I told her, and she was totally amazed.
They come to you?
She came yesterday to fit her for a bath chair because her muscles, her trunk, this is called her trunk muscles. The muscles here. Mm-hmm. Right here, her trunk muscles are kind of loose, so when she's in the bathtub, she's not able to sit up for long periods of time.
Mm-hmm.
So they came to fit her for a bath chair, which sits in the tub and, you know, supports her back, helps her to hold those muscles.
Well, you're not going to believe this, but I've just been given a sign by Brother Lester there that our time has elapsed again. So now we're going to have to come back in another year or so and get the next update. So this is Blaze and Unified Fathers for Life, and this is Stacy McDonald, and this is Lila, the Miracle Baby. And now this show is called The Miracle Baby, what?
The Toddler Years.
The Toddler Years. And we are so honored to have her, and all you people who have children with cerebral palsy, good luck to you. We look forward to contacting you. If you want to contact us at the end of the show, you see information. We look forward to it. Say bye-bye.
Say bye-bye.
Say bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Say bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Don't be afraid. Let it shine. Around and things are so weak.